edition, EG16 Wing Guard Brushed Folding Quadcopter Review. The EG16 is a low power, because it has brushed motors, quadcopter with a 4K camera, as it said on the box. It supports, according to the box and what it writes in the back, 14 minutes flight time. It has electronic stabilization, active track, one key return, because this one has a GPS, and also supports a 360 point of interest mode and follow me with the application. It's not stated on the box this, but the application does support it, and also gesture control, so that you can take photos and start-stop video recording using gestures. The application is available for Android and iOS, and the application supports video editing and a Beautify filter. The FPV system used is a Wi-Fi 5G. This quadcopter was bought from Banggood.com. Let's open the box. Inside the box, we can find the instruction manual, the quadcopter with a battery, the transmitter. Underneath, there is a bag that contains 1, 2, 3, 4 spare blades, a USB battery charger, 4 blade protectors, and 1 screwdriver. The EG16, as we said in the prologue, is a brushed foldable quadcopter. The class is 250. It's made completely from plastic, but it has a rubbery coating. It's a bit not flexible, but it will absorb more easily crashes because of this material. We have 4 LEDs, one on each leg, 2 red ones on the front and 2 green ones on the back. These are used to denote the state of the quadcopter. On the bottom of the quadcopter, we find the on-off switch, a down-facing camera that can be used both for taking pictures and video. It's not a good resolution camera, however, and as an optical flow camera, on the other hand, to allow easier and more accurate the flying height. Above the camera, we'll find the micro SD card slot. The quadcopter does not come with a micro SD card, you have to provide your own. It supports up to 32 GB micro SD cards. On the front of the quadcopter, we'll see we have the front facing 4K camera. The resolution 4K is only for photos, however. Video is recorded on 1080p at 25 frames per second. The camera is mounted onto a one-axis servo gimbal. It's not a gimbal, it's a servo mechanism. On the back of the quadcopter, we find a big LED that turns green, solid green, when we have a solid GPS lock. The battery is a proprietary type, like a cassette. It's 1800 milliamps, 2S. No, it's a 1S, 1S battery, 3.85 volts, as you can see. That's interesting. It's a 1S battery, but it's a lipo high voltage one. According to the manufacturers, the quadcopter can fly up to 14 minutes with this battery. The transmitter is a standard transmitter with a built-in telemetry screen underneath the smartphone clamp. Quality wise, it's pretty good for the price, pretty solid. Here we have the one key return button. This button activates and deactivates the headless mode. This button turns on and off the transmitter, and this one enters the compass calibration mode. The pitch and throttle sticks are pretty nice, very responsive. On the back of the unit we have two buttons. This one is used to take photos. This one starts and stops video recording. This one increases and decreases the expo value so that the angle of the quadcopter is leaner, so it flies faster. And this button is used for aiming the camera upwards or downwards. Do not try to move the camera with your hand or you risk ruining the servo mechanic. Let's activate the EG16 now. You turn on the quadcopter first and you place it on the ground to initialize, and then you turn on the transmitter by pressing this button until it turns on. As you can see now, there are three red dots flashing on the transmitter, which means that the quadcopter is not bound yet to the transmitter. To bind the transmitter to the quadcopter, you just move the throttle pitch up and down one. Hear the beep, solid red lights, bound. Please note that until you bind the quadcopter to the transmitter, the display telemetry is not correct. Only when bound, the telemetry downloads the data from the quadcopter. We are ready now to connect to the application too, and we search for the Wi-Fi access point, which denotes as Wi-Fi, 4K, 5G, and some identification string. It's connected. Don't forget also to enable the GPS on your mobile phone, because the application needs it in order to support Follow Me and Orbit or Waypoint flight. Right now we are connected to the access point of the quadcopter and we start the FPV Go application. On the main menu of the application we have the Start Flight button, an instructions button that displays instructions in Chinese only, the records button which displays the flight log of the quadcopter, and the setting button which allows you to switch the language between English and Chinese. One note here, the application is about 60 to 65% complete in English. As you will see later, the whole video editor and some large parts of it are still in Chinese. However, it's very stable, it hasn't crashed in any circumstances. Continuing the options of the menu, we have the on-off record switch, which allows us to turn on a recording automatically upon arming the quadcopter. The app update and the firmware update buttons do nothing. Even if you are connected to the Wi-Fi, as it asks, it still says that there's no available version. The stabilization button turns on and off the electronic stabilization of the camera. I don't know the Chinese option what it does. Maybe it's off in Chinese, who knows. I don't know. The on switch, there's the middle switch, which if someone can help us translate it what it does. And the off switch turns off the stabilization. My opinion here regarding stabilization is that it ruins the video, because it still records at 1080p at 25 frames per second, but it doesn't capture 25 per second, meaning that when the quadcopter is flying and it's moving, The movement is very slow. It's like someone has used the slow motion to stabilize the video. It doesn't make sense to me. And lastly, the 4K correction, which corrects the fisheye of the camera in 4K. Remember that the 4K camera shoots 4K only in photo mode. In video mode, it shoots only 1080p at 25 frames per second. And the start flight enters the main FPV screen, where we're greeted with some introduction for beginners, some more instructions, and this is the main application menu. The application supports zoom in and zoom out on the FPV screen, as you can see using your two fingers, but it's not actually a digital zoom function, it's only for the preview. From bottom left to top, we have the one key return to home button, the orbit switch button, the follow me button, and the waypoint editor with the map, where we can, when we are in GPS mode and have enough satellites look, we can draw a map on the map so that the quadcopter can fly there. I haven't tested it yet. On the top of the screen, on the bar, we have from the left the Wi-Fi signal strength. Next to it, there is the icon for the optical flow mode or a GPS mode for the current flight mode. Next to it, there is a flashing satellite icon. The quadcopter cannot possibly look satellites here inside. Next to it, there is a battery indicator. Next to it, there are the telemetry indications for the, from the GPS, such as the altitude, the distance from the transmitter, the horizontal and vertical speed, and the longitude and latitude of the GPS lock. The plus 50 icon is another way to activate the zoom function, 30% zoom, up to 50%, as they say. Next to it, there is a button that switches between the front-facing camera and the downward-facing camera. Here is what the downward-facing camera sees. Pretty lame. Next to this icon, there's the virtual reality button, which turns the display into a split screen that can be used together with some casket, FPV casket, so that you can have an FPV goggle solution. The SD icon switches between the standard definition and the high definition transmission for the FPV signal. Unfortunately, on the high definition mode, the lag is insanely high. See when how slow the quadcopter moved. This can also be used to stabilize the video. But in reality, it ruins the FPV while flying. Next to this icon, there is the gallery icon, which allows us to enter the gallery and delete, transfer, or edit the photos and videos that we have stored on the SD card. The icon next to it, this arrow, returns us to the main screen. Underneath, there is an eye icon that, when pressed, activates the gestures, the gesture control of the quadcopter. The quadcopter supports three types of gestures. One type to take photos, and two types of that can be used to turn on and off video recording. Let's try to demonstrate that. To take a photo, you aim at the camera and do the victory sign, as we can see. Took a photo. To turn on video recording, you do a box, a frame like that. It's not always detected, so it has a second option to turn on and off video recording. You just hold your hand with all fingers closed like this. Video recording has started, as you can see, and you can stop it again by doing the same gesture. Stopped, not yet. Now it stopped. Underneath the gesture control button, there is the camera shooting mode switch, which can be used to switch between a shooting video or taking photos when using the application, or you can still use the buttons on the transmitter, much easier, much faster. Underneath there is the shutter button, and the MV button finally is the music video, as they call it, the video editor, which allows you to perform some effects on the video or images. However, I cannot understand what they are saying because they are in Chinese. And also allows you to select your video or image, do some cropping and other options, or choose some music. It has music inside. Okay, going back. Pretty straightforward application. A pity that it's not fully translated in English. We can only hope that they will translate it later sometime to fully use it. Finally, in order to arm the quadcopter, you just push the sticks inside like this. The quadcopter will disarm its motors if we do not issue a throttle command within 5 seconds. And finally, we also have the compass calibration option, as we said earlier, that can only be activated when we are outside and have a solid GPS log. As you can see now, the LED here does not flash solid green. It tries to acquire satellites, but it can't inside. The procedure is as follows. You enter the compass calibration mode, pick up, turn horizontally the quadcopter, clockwise, counterclockwise, it doesn't matter, until the bottom front green LEDs turn on green, solid green, and the back one, the red ones are flashing. Then you turn the quadcopter with the camera upwards or downwards, still doesn't matter, and rotate it like this until all LEDs are solid lit. Then you put it on the ground and it's finished. To perform the gyroscope or accelerometer calibration, you have to do that only after a crash. It comes calibrated from the factory, however, it doesn't hurt to do it, just to be sure. The only warning I can give you is that you should do it on a completely level surface, otherwise you'll have issues flying in optical flow mode, the quadcopter will drift. In order to do that, you just push the throttle and the pitch stick lower to the right side, like this. Hold them. All four LEDs will turn blinking red and green. You do not touch the quadcopter at this time and wait until all LEDs are again solid lit. And you're done. Overall, it's a pretty nice quadcopter, a very good choice in my opinion for beginners. It's pretty complete, it has everything, it has GPS, it has a full set of spares, it has blade protectors, a lot of flight modes to choose from. It's pretty stable. I really liked how it flies in GPS mode. It's fast, however, it's pretty stable. I didn't notice any toilet bowl effect, which is common in cheaper quadcopters or other quadcopters at this price range. The optical flow mode, I'm not pretty sure that it works right now, because the quadcopter, although it I've tested it on a rough surface in order to help the down facing camera to detect the difference and help her, and help the camera stabilize more the flight attitude, I still had issues regarding the flight. It kept doing some slight variations up and down. These variations, however, are not there when we are flying in fully GPS mode. So it really has to do with the camera not being correctly used, maybe from the optical flow algorithm. The video is 1080p, 25 frames per second. Pretty decent in my opinion, and it's a standard frame rate, so you won't have any issues using it with a video editor. There will be a second video of the flight test. Thank you very much for watching this small review. Please like the video and subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you soon. Bye bye.